So I'm Etiene da Cruz Dalcol. I'm a software engineering student from Brazil. I'm currently studying in France. And I also develop Sailor, which is a Lua MVC web framework. So some months ago, I was invited to represent MLH at a conference called Women's International Leadership at Bremen. And besides presenting MLH and inviting people to hackathons, I was supposed to give a two-hour length workshop on introduction to programming. And I learned a lot of things that I would like to share with you. So some of the topics I'll cover during the talk are why using JavaScript instead of some other language, what is feasible in such a short time, why inspiring people is important, and and my personal growth of all of this. So let's begin with the choice of JavaScript. Well, a particular language was not imposed on me. I was just told I was supposed to give an introduction workshop. So I was free to choose whatever I wanted. So the story actually does not begin with JavaScript. It begins with Lua. So 1 week before the conference, I participated in a hackathon where I built a duck hunt game using Lua and a game development framework called Love2D. And I was really impressed at how fast and fun that was. I mean, you can look at my face. I seem to be having a lot of fun. And I never did lots of game development, but it actually reminded me of my first programming experience. There was this online game called Ragnarok Online, and we could run local servers using emulators, and we could modify the game. And I remember exactly the first day where I got my own non-playing character working, and I could click on it, and it would do exactly what I told it to do. And it was magical. It was powerful. And I thought, if I could relate to that, maybe some other people would. So I said, OK, I'll go with them through this game I had just made in Lua. But then there were some problems. Well, not really problems, but things that could get improved. And I started considering some other options. So I had 2 hours, and I really just wanted to cover some basics, variables, arrays, et cetera. And we need to be really careful when picking a language to teach a beginner, because sometimes it's almost as if we forget the basic structure of a language. So for example, I could go for a language just because it has lots of libraries, lots of tools, lots of tutorials specific for beginners, for example, Python. But I remember my first Python day. And I remember taking over 30 minutes to find out what was wrong with my code when it looked exactly like the tutorial was following. It looked equal, but just didn't work. It was because somewhere in the code, there were 4 spaces where there was supposed to be a tab, and I started having homicidal thoughts. And so I said, maybe let's consider some other options. So what about JavaScript? I said, well, maybe it's kind of complex, right? You can do incredible stuff with JavaScript. But then I thought, well, we don't need the whole thing. We just need a subset of the language. And the subset is not scary at all to beginners. So I said, OK, JavaScript seems like a good choice. And going on, another point is that I wouldn't be given the workshop alone. Well, 150 people is a lot of people. So the conference organized a wonderful team of volunteers. And they would walk around, assisting participants and everything. And well, it would just be better if you use a language that we all had in common. I mean, Lua is great, but it's somewhat obscure. And JavaScript was the language we all knew. And there's also the question about the tools needed. So setting up a development environment already isn't the quickest and nicest and most pleasant activities we take before starting to program something. And while Lua and the Love2D framework are really super easy to get going, I'm saying that from my perspective as a software engineering student. I was dealing with an audience that consisted mostly of non-tech participants. So the perfect thing would be to reduce this time and effort to zero. And JavaScript offered that too. Because everyone already has what it takes to code JavaScript on their computers. Everyone already has a browser and text editors, or even just a browser. So someone with the team suggested we used a Mozilla symbol, which turned out to be great because we can pull out the code and see the results side by side. It gives instant feedback. It's really easy to use. So to sum up, well, JavaScript has zero effort to set up everything. It doesn't need additional libraries or frameworks to make graphics, which makes everything very easy to remember in case they want to try it out later. And it's also pretty useful on a beginner's context. I mean, I'm sure the first program will not be a TCP/IP protocol, and I know that they don't want to know what monads are. So JavaScript enables people to write games and websites, which is exactly the same kind of software they have direct contact with on a daily basis. So OK, the plan is set. I was going to port my game from Lua to JavaScript and starting to plan the workshop. So let's talk about the feasibility in 2 hours. This is a part very detail-oriented because every tiny thing we can do to save time counts. So I gather some tips and tricks from my adventure to share with you. So first, I recommend having everything ready. Even if you're teaching something very simple, I wouldn't suggest improvising. Not because you could make a mistake and make a fool of yourself in front of everyone. I mean, if you're giving a workshop, chances are you know more than the audience. So you really don't have to worry about that. But the thing is, if you make a mistake, you lose time. And if you lose time, you take away from the audience the opportunity to learn something else they could have been learning during that time. So having that in mind, a skeleton code is very useful. While you could teach much more by developing everything from scratch, it is simply not feasible. So what I did exactly was that I prepared the whole game, and then I removed some parts so I could let them like fill and modify. And for example, when I first explained what a variable is, I would say, oh, hey, here is a variable called scale. It's being used to multiply the width and height of all images in game. And if you modify it, you can see the whole game like shrink or enlarge. And when I would first talk about functions, I could say, hey, let's make the function that make the duck move, and so on. So every tiny bit of the game was something I wanted to teach. Now, this is something that looks really simple, but it's really useful compared to the effort it takes to get going. Because having a short, easy, and pronounceable URL can save a whole 5-10 minutes of the participants being clueless and asking each other what's going on. So I really suggest that if you have anything to download or any materials to share. Give them time to write their code, but be prepared to say time's up, give out the answer, and move on to the next topic. Because it's normal if the participants get stuck in some aspect, but you don't have to stop the workshop there and wait until everyone is done. Because some students, they might not come up with a good answer by themselves, but they will understand once you explain it. And I also suggest not moving to the next topic without first giving the answer to the last one. Because you might lose someone there. A participant may get stuck and trying to solve that little thing until the end of the workshop and get out of there really frustrated. And believe me, you don't want people to get out of your workshop frustrated. It can also happen that you don't have time to show them everything you planned. So I really recommend leaving the extra things for the end. So in my case, for example, I was planning to teach the module operator by making the wings of the duck flap and some flux control by hitting the duck and killing it. So we need to think what is more important of a lesson in terms of programming and what makes more sense in the whole context. So in the case of my workshop, I wanted the participants to have a complete and playable game by the end, so the duck had to die. So I moved the wing flap into the end, and it was a good idea because in the end, we did run out of time, and it did have to be cut off. And the last thing before I move on to the next topic is typography. I'm giving a special attention to this because this is something I screwed up. So you are learning from my mistake, which is way better than learning from your own mistakes. So what I was doing was that I was switching between slides and the code on Mozilla symbol. And when I was explaining something using the slides, well, like I said, I was presenting MLH. And they have a branded style they use for all presentations in the company. So I didn't give much thought to it. So this slide, for example, it worked just fine. But when I said, hey, let's make the function that makes the duck move, then it didn't work at all. Can you guess why? Yes. It was horrible for them to know what exactly were parentheses or brackets or curlies on my crappy slides, and it confused the hell out of them when I switched the code. And the funny thing is that I did show the slides to friends who were programmers, to people on the team, to people from MLH, and nobody has a flag there. Because this is obvious to us, we already know those are parentheses. When it's not obvious to us, then it's really, really irritating. And I got particularly mad at myself because I'm often complaining when professors do this. And then I went and did the very same thing. So, yeah. I'll definitely take this as a lesson for the next time. Typography is really important. Okay, so we got to the end. We were able to do the whole game during the workshop with moving ducks that could be shot and killed. And to me, this is huge. This is a huge progress for 2 hours. And we should be making this more often. But given that, teaching a practical skill alone is not enough. Inspiring is important too. So I wanted to give them reasons to feel encouraged so they could enjoy the technicality a bit more and also get curious once the workshop is over so they can experiment with it later and maybe start programming more. But how do you go from one stage to the other? Well, one way is to show them examples of things they can build or do with technology. You can also show them people having fun with things they can build. Well, a particular aspect of my workshop was that it was directed at young women. And I really wanted to show them that computer science and programming is indeed a place where women can be, which is something I am constantly not convinced myself. So we all know this universe can be a little challenging to women, so please forgive my crappy drawing abilities. That one is me. I'm really happy to see such a diverse conference here. But more often than not, I am the only woman in the room when I'm dealing with technology. And I really wanted to show them that this is not the case, that this does not represent the reality as a whole. So I really wanted to show them role models. Because it can be really demotivating when we see only images of successful males in our field. Because if we don't see people like us doing these things, we believe we can do these things as well. So as I was searching pictures and stories to show them, the first time I felt it was really important, because we have been discussing this often in our community, and I'm really happy about it. But this is when I felt it for real. Because when I was looking for the stories to show them, I realized that I was really excited. I was really happy to show these wonderful women to these other women. And it struck me that here I am. I am programming. I am teaching programming. And I'm not going anywhere. So this was a moment that I absolutely needed to go through this list of amazing women. And I'm not sure when I'll stop stop needing that. So um, And I hope that this was as important to the audience as was for me. I hope some of them were positively surprised to hear some of those names for the first time, just like I was when I first heard of them as well. And when I saw the room filled with women programming, so excited about their ducks moving for the first time, I did learn something else. I mean, look at her, she seems to actually be enjoying it. And I can't really express in words how it was by the end of the workshop. There was this woman that came to me and said, "Computers hate me. Everything I touch crashes. I'm just horrible with computers." But she managed to get everything working, and she was so happy. And she was asking me for materials, and so I just gave her like Code Academy links and everything. And it was amazing. And there were other people who were asking how to modify the game, and she doing this or that. And it got me like this ear-to-ear smile that I just can't get off my face. And I learned that teaching is so rewarding. This is the moment I said, I must do this for life. This is amazing. So if you forget, like, everything I've been saying on this talk, please remember this. Teach people. If you have any time to spare, reserve some time to teach people. Especially if it relates to something you care about. Because it gets us this feeling, we can do this. We can totally do this. In 2 hours, we can do amazing things. And while people were coming to thank me for the workshop, I was thanking them. So, I was thanking them, and it was such an amazing feeling that I want everyone else to feel the same. So I'm pretty happy to share all the materials of my talk, of my workshop. If you go on my GitHub repository, you'll find everything. You'll find the full code, you'll find the skeleton code, you'll find the slides. I have made a different version of the slides with different typography. And so you can download everything. I also have the old version for people that work with MLH by any chance. So I'm finishing this really early, and I'm really mad. But yeah, this is the end of my talk. If you have any questions, I'll be around. You can also find me on Twitter. And that's it. Thank you.